Good Friday. Today we've come together to celebrate Good Friday. I say celebrate somewhat reluctantly because the death of an innocent man isn't something we would normally celebrate. On a different day, in a different situation, with a different man, we would all cry out in protest. We would march against the injustice. The story would be printed in bold on every newspaper. Every home, every office, every school would be talking about the horrible injustice and inhumanity of an innocent man dying for crimes he did not commit. Yes, on a different day, in a different situation, with a different man, we would be outraged. But there's no outrage today. There's no march against injustice. Today there's joy, celebration even. Not the usual celebration with parties and cakes and friends, but celebration just the same. And there's a reverence, a quiet reverence, a holy hush, an endless gratitude, because we understand the significance of this day. On this Friday, you and I and the worldwide body of Christ come together as one, and we look again at the cross. We look at the injustice, we look at the inhumanity, we look at the cruelty and the pain. We see anew the face of our Jesus, twisted in agony. We hear the crowd yelling. We smell the sweat and the blood. And sometimes we might even begin to imagine, to feel just a tiny bit of the incredible agony and pain of the burden that was put on Jesus. And it's in that moment that we remember the reason for it all. We look at his eyes full of love and forgiveness, and we see the pain and the tears, but we see it in a new light because he wasn't a different man in a different situation. This was Jesus, and he chose this. It was for this moment he came, leaving the splendor and majesty of heaven. It was for this moment he took on human flesh and he dwelt among us. It was in this moment that we beheld his glory. We, finite, sinful, desperate human beings, beheld the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So yes, we celebrate because this moment is God's moment. A moment of reconciliation between holy God and sinful man. A moment of unmerited grace and infinite love like no other moment in all of human history. Tonight you'll hear from the perspective of three people who saw Jesus' suffering firsthand. First, you'll hear from a woman whose son was crucified right next to Jesus. Next, you'll hear from John, the apostle who Jesus loved and who stood close by while the Savior suffered. Finally, you'll hear from Mary, Jesus' mother, who knew from the beginning that this was her son's journey, but who felt the pain of loss so keenly. For those faithful friends then, and for us here today, we reflect on this great sacrifice. Good Friday. Today we celebrate Good Friday.
I was lost, I was It's a beautiful song. The blood of Jesus. This is the good news of Good Friday from the Gospel of Mark. And as they were eating, Jesus took some bread and he blessed it. And he broke it into pieces and he gave it to the disciples saying, "Take, for this is my body." And he took a cup of wine and he gave thanks to God for it. And he gave it to them. And they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood, which confirms the covenant between my Father God and his people. My blood is poured out as a sacrifice for many. I tell you the truth. I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Jesus is in the upper room. It's the Last Supper. What a moment for Jesus. Do you ever think about it that way? What a moment. I mean, he's looking out at his disciples. He's looking out at his friends. He's looking out at the men he probably loved more than any other people in the world. As a matter of fact, the Bible says Jesus was looking forward to this time in the upper room. They've spent 3 years together. They've camped together. They've gone on journeys together. 3 years. I'm thinking to myself, Jesus knows, can you imagine this? He knows as he looks at them, this is the last time that we will be together on this side. Imagine the emotion that must have gone on in Jesus' mind. He's thinking to himself, "This is it, brothers, this is it. All right, I got this loaf of bread. I'm gonna break it, and I want you to pass it to each other. I want you to take this bread and eat it." And he's thinking to himself, they don't really know what they're doing. It's the first communion, remember. And then he's thinking, okay, guys, here's this cup of wine. I want you to pass it to each other. I want you to drink. I want you to remember that this wine is my blood shed for you. They didn't know. Jesus knew. Jesus is thinking, you don't totally understand. Oh, but in about 12 hours, you will. Take and eat, take and drink, he said. This is Good Friday. See, we know tonight what they didn't know at that Last Supper. Do you realize that? See, they didn't know what was coming. We know. We celebrate it every year. We know about the cross. They didn't know about the cross. The soldiers took Jesus into the courtyard of the garden, of the governor's headquarters. And he called out the entire regiment, and they dressed him in a purple robe, and they wove thorn branches into a crown, and they put it on Jesus' head, and then they saluted him, and they mocked him, and they taunted him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" The soldiers are doing this. They struck him on the head with a reed stick. They spit on him. They dropped to their knees in mock worship. And when they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the purple robe and they put his own clothes on him again. And then they led him out to be crucified. They crucified him. Good Friday. The cross is about the supreme sacrifice that Jesus paid for us. The cross is about is about the blood, his blood that was shed for us. The cross is about his willingness to die for you and me. Do you realize it was just Thursday night that he was praying so fervently that he was sweating, and the Bible says drops of blood. Oh, Father, if this cup could just pass from me. But Jesus knew the answer, didn't he? But he prayed. But see, folks, friends, when it was settled, it was settled. The cross is about the fact that Jesus didn't hesitate after Thursday night. He went willingly to the cross. That's what the cross is about. Oh, the cross is about the love of God also. The Bible says, because the Father loved you, because the Father loved me, he sends his only Son to die for us. See, that's love. Imagine a father seeing his only Son, having to go through what we just read, but realizing he even has to look away because he knows there's no other way that his Son would have to die for a world that could care less about him. But it had to be done. Oh, what love. The cross is about the Father's love. Oh, what love the Father has for us. In this weekend, think about this before you get to church on Sunday. Never doubt his love. Never say again, oh, God doesn't love me. Oh, what love. The cross is about that love. The cross brings us closer to Jesus. The cross brings us closer to the Father. The cross is bigger than any sin. The cross is bigger than any failure. The cross is bigger than any condition that you might be in tonight. It's bigger than that. The good news of Good Friday, yes, it's good news, is that Jesus on the cross defeated hell and death forever. That's the good news of the cross. So let's remember the cross tonight, and let's take our cups. And let's take that little wafer out. And as you're taking it out, don't take it yet, don't eat it yet. But as you're taking it out and you're holding it in your hand, let's remember the cross. See, because we know what happened on the cross. We could take communion tonight with so much more meaning than the disciples did. Take this wafer, remembering that it is the body of Jesus Christ that was broken for you and I. Take now in remembrance of that. And then the cup. Remember, we know what happened. The disciples on that first communion didn't. So take this cup and drink, knowing that we drink because his blood was shed for us. Take and drink together. Oh, Lord, thank you for the cross. Thank you for the ability to break bread and drink a cup in remembrance of what you did for us. We will never forget. Thank you. We will never forget your willingness to go to the cross for us. We will never forget the love of your Father, of our Father, who loved us enough to send his only Son to die so that we could have eternal life. Thank you for the cross, dear Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, for your blood.
He's gone. My son, gone. Executed. He has a name, you know. Not that anyone in that blood-hungry crowd cared, but his name is Dismas. I named him that after my father. He was a good man. He died when Dismas was just a toddler, but right after the baby was born, my father came to visit. He was so proud to have his namesake.
He sat me down and said, "Tabitha, here's what I want you to remember. He's a boy. Take him to the synagogue. Teach him the ways of our people. Most important, daughter, teach him of God, of justice, mercy, and humility." And I did. He was quite a student, you know. He learned the books of the law by heart. He was a good boy, always looking out for the underdog. He never could stand to see someone getting bullied. More than once, the rabbi came by to talk to his father and me about how Dismas had shoved down a bigger boy or hit someone for picking on the smaller boys. I told him more than once that he had to learn to control his temper. He always said the same thing. "Remember, Mama, Proverbs says, speak up for the people who have no voice, for the rights of all of the down and outers." It was hard to argue with that, though I scolded him for his methods. As he got older, those methods got more extreme. These last few years, as the Romans have tightened their grip on our region, Dismas became more of a rebel. He let his anger get the best of him. I saw him less and less. He turned from compassion and kindness to violence and retribution. Last week, it caught up with him. The neighbor boy came running to tell me that Dismas has been arrested and was going on trial. I hurried to the prefect's court and arrived just in time to hear the verdict. Guilty of treason in the Roman government. I hadn't seen Dismas in months, but I threw myself in front of him and turned to face Pilate. I pleaded with him to have mercy. I tried to explain his motives. It did no good. He was sentenced to be crucified. This morning at Golgotha, my son carried his cross past me. Through tears, I told him I loved him. He told me he loved me, and he said, "Remember, Mama, speak for the voiceless." And then the soldiers shoved me aside and led me to the top of the hill. I turned away as they carried out the sentence. But I couldn't leave. After a while, I looked at the scene of the hilltop. The man in the middle had been beaten badly. And the man on the other side of him was yelling vile insults. My son, my Dismas, even as he hung there in agony, spoke up and he said, "Can't you see this man is innocent?" My compassionate boy denied mercy himself. He still found the strength to call for mercy for another. And then he spoke to the man on the middle cross. "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." The man in the middle, bloody and bruised, struggling for every breath, turned his face toward my son. With great effort, he spoke. "Today, you will be with me in paradise." I don't know much about that man in the middle, but it seems Dismas might have. I've heard his name. I want to believe him. I want to believe he has the power to deliver my son into paradise. And maybe he can deliver me as well. No, I don't want to believe. I do believe. Savior, Remember me.
It is. They say particular senses are linked really closely with memory. I guess that's true. The smell of burned bread definitely brings back strong memories of my mother's cooking. But I think the one that does it for me is the sense of touch. Just thinking about a certain texture can take me back to a moment, like the rough lines of a fishing net sliding through my hands. No matter how old I get or how far from the lake I am, I'll never forget how it feels to tie a knot, to mend a hole in a torn net. You can lose a lot of good fish if you're not careful. And when that's your livelihood, you learn to mend those holes quickly and carefully. That was what I was doing the day when we first heard his voice. I was tying knots, and my brother was gathering it up as I did, so it didn't get tangled. Not fun, but necessary. We'd been out to hear the wilderness preacher a few times. He was captivating. Wild hair, strange garments, and he had told us to watch for the Messiah. He told us to be watching. So I was. I listened to all the rumors about conquerors and potential rulers and those who claimed to be the deliverer, but I just couldn't figure out who it was supposed to be and what I was supposed to do about it, even if I figured it out. And then it happened. That day, when I was just sitting there with my brother on our boat anchored just offshore, working hard, fixing the nets, came a voice from the shore. Follow me. Can't explain to you how those words hit me. I didn't just hear them, I felt them. I looked at the man on shore and he looked back. Again, he said, follow me. It wasn't harsh. It wasn't a command. It was an invitation, an exclamation, an opportunity. And I didn't know it then, but those words, they were a promise. I let the net fall and followed him. The last 3 years have gone by quickly, and right now, much of it is a blur. But I remember how some things felt. I remember stooping down and feeling what was left of the mud he made with the saliva and dirt, while he stepped forward and spread it on that blind man's eyes. It just felt like regular mud. But using it, he made the man see. I remember reaching in and picking up the last piece of bread, feeling the bottom of the basket with my fingers, only to reach in a moment later and find that there was still more. I remember the hungry hands of people grasping for bread that only moments ago hadn't even existed. I remember picking up a shard of broken jar, which seconds earlier had held valuable perfume. I remember tracing my thumb over the sharp edge while he spoke gently to the young woman who had poured that perfume out on him. I remember the feeling of my shoulder resting against him as the 13 of us reclined around the table that night. I remember reaching out for him too late, feeling his cloak pulled from my fingers as the soldiers led him away. I remember. What will I remember today? I will remember the feeling of his mother's head resting on my shoulder. I will remember the warmth of her quiet tears soaking through my cloak. I will remember how she trembled as he spoke to both of us. He hung there in agony, and then came that same voice that called me to follow, not as strong, but just as clear, first to his mother, then to me. Woman, behold your son. Behold your mother. In his last moments, from within that dark shadow of aloneness, he reminded us that we are not meant to be alone. He reminded us of our need for each other. We are meant to be woven together, much like a net, depending on the strength of another, mending the broken places, working together for his purpose. I will remember.
Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. In every broken place, you are my righteousness. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Just as I am, I come. Hallelujah. Oh, what amazing love, say. Thank you, Jesus. Just as I am, I come. Hallelujah. Oh, what amazing
I watched every moment. It is the hardest thing a mother could ever have to do. But if, through his swollen, blackened eyes, he looked down from that cross, darkened by the shadow of awful crucifixion, I wanted to make sure that he saw the face of one person who loved him. And he did. I almost broke down. His eyes met mine, the same eyes that looked back at me from that hay-filled manger. The eyes brimmed with tears as I cleaned his skinned elbow. The eyes that read the scrolls in the synagogue. The eyes that looked over Jerusalem and wept. The eyes that saw every need, every hurt, every wound, every sinful soul, and refused to look away. I knew long ago he was meant for a purpose. I mean, when an angel comes to visit you, you begin to understand that this baby you're carrying might be something more. When shepherds come to kneel at his makeshift cradle, a mother suspects that her baby's life will not be an ordinary one. When wise men bring gifts worth more money than what the carpenter shop brings in a year, a mother knows Yahweh has a plan much bigger than she can wrap her mind around. When a mother finds her 12-year-old explaining the law and prophets to the greatest teachers in Jerusalem, she can be certain there is something different in store for this boy. When your son looks you in your face and he says, "I must be about my father's business," and something tells you he isn't talking about carpentry, your heart skips a beat with the realization that the road ahead will not be an easy one. When your son turns plain water into the finest wine, when he restores sight, when he heals the lame, when he raises the dead, you know this proves the divine intention behind his birth. These are the memories I've treasured in my heart. But a mother will worry, won't she? And I have. The more attention he drew to himself, the more the authorities threatened and whispered, the more I found myself wishing he would just come back to the carpenter shop and make a simple living. He was quite a good carpenter, you know. From the time Joseph taught him the skills, he worked hard to master them. I loved watching him work, pounding, sanding, sawing, tables, chairs, bowls, ladles. And when each one matched the plan that he'd sketch out on parchment, he'd wipe away the dust, step back, arms out, smile, and say three simple words. Three words that were a declaration of completion. I heard those words again today. And a mother knows, I knew. They meant much the same thing, though infinitely magnified. No furniture, no housewares this time. But still, there was a plan sketched out and in place since before my son was formed in my womb, and I suspect for much longer. Today, on that cross, with his arms spread, I am almost positive that I saw on that bruised, wounded, blood-covered face, beyond belief, a smile. And I knew before he said them the words that came next. It is finished. But a mother knows things. Yes. Without a doubt, it is finished. But it isn't over.
So beautiful. So inspiring. Well, thank you for coming to the first night of this Good Friday Easter weekend. Hope you can join us tomorrow. We have a great day planned. For the first time, you'll be able to see our new Sunday school, and we'll have a family day and then an incredible Easter service. But remember what you heard tonight. Apply it. Meditate on it. God bless you. We'll see you tomorrow and then on Easter Sunday.